Thank you very much, Dr. Sartas, and thank you for coming. It's a pleasure to be here. It's actually my third talk in the last 10 months, and I find quite challenging from time to time to find a good topic to this ground round that was not discussed previously. And I think that this specific topic is quite an interesting one, and there is a lot of enthusiasm in one side and a little bit of despair in the other side. So there's a lot of emotion in this topic, and I would like to present it to you, the evolution of this topic. And as Dr. Sotas mentioned, it's one of those few topics, not only in urology, but in medicine, that there is some kind of discrepancy about the guidelines of the old continent of Western Europe comparing to North America. And it's quite interesting to see that. And I'll try to reach this point either. So if you're discussing about the pharmacological aspects of the therapy of stress urinary incontinence, and I think I need your help because it doesn't work. Okay, thank you. So my objective for today is to review the evolution, especially of two components of drugs. The first one is the adrenergic one, and the second one is the serotonin and noradrenaline reuptake inhibitor, to appreciate what is the change of that. And then after that, touch base a bit about any supplements that are available and other kind of optional treatment, oral treatment for this issue. So just a little bit about baseline. If we're discussing about the definition, the International Incontinence Society addressed that stress urinary incontinence is this involuntary loss of urine on effort or exertion with sneezing, coughing, etc. It's very important to be appreciated that there are some mechanism for that. And in the past, we know that there was there is still these types of stress urinary incontinence, which was strictly either urethral hypermobility or intrinsic sphincter deficiency. Right now, it looks like it's more kind of spectrum thing, that during the evolution of the stress urinary incontinence, it seems to be that most of the patients have suffering for both of those, and during the day maybe there is some kind of shift from one side to the other side, but still it seems like it exists in most of the women, both of those kind of mechanisms. If we are speaking about the prevalence of stress urinary incontinence, we should appreciate that this is actually a chronic disease, and it's much more prevalent comparing other chronic diseases such as hypertension, depression, and diabetes. The prevalence is quite high. If we are discussing only in Canada, there are some data about that, and it seems that at least 10 to 20% of Canadian women suffer of this entity. The stress urinary incontinence is the main, the dominant component of the urinary incontinence. There is a social stigma that we should know and be aware of, and that's why only minority of the patients are seeking for healthcare for that problem. Another thing that we should deal with is about the definition. How many times is this problem happening during the day and during the week, and that's actually an effect on the quality of life. Discussing the risk factors of stress urinary incontinence, it's not only this chronic exertion kind of lifting heavy things, but there's quite a multiple risk factors for the stress urinary incontinence. Some of those are really related to elevated intra-abdominal pressure. The other is some kind of maybe deficiency, innervation deficiency of the pelvic floor, and there are other different factors, including genetic factors as well. Regarding the quality of life, it's an aspect that we should be aware of in the daily life. People are seeking to improve their quality of life. It's well definited and more popularized in the last 20 years. And we, as mentioned by the World Health Organization, it has a quite a strict relation to the goals and standards and concerns, and that we should be aware when discussing with our patients about optional treatment. So the treatment options right now, it seems like we are starting from the first line, which is the conservative line, changing the daily life, the habitual life, and then using some kind of pelvic physiotherapy. We may combine it with some of the mechanical device, either using pessary with knob, or there's some newer device. One of those is the urista. I'm not sure if you're aware of. It's a kind of tampon-like device with a knob, which is like more easier to deal with that for most of the women. And then after that, it seems like the second line is the surgical component. And we quite aware of that. And one of my secondary goal of today is try to discuss the treatment of stress urinary incontinence without discussing the surgical issues. And it seems that there is some kind of gap between the first and the second line. And we are now quite aware that a lot of the disease, there is some pharmacological option that may be somehow related and treated prior to any kind of surgical or definitive treatment. So who may actually be benefited from this pharmacological treatment? We know that there are patients that are actually bad candidates for any kind of surgical treatment. And those patients need some kind of result for the problem. The second, I think, group of people that may we should think about is those healthy women who knows about the procedure, but knows the procedure, like the surgical procedures have quite a good success rate, but still it's not 100%. And as we know, and they know, they are aware of the risk factors and the side effects and the complication of especially the new mid-urethral sling procedure, and they'll try to avoid that risk factors. Another thing is those women who are aware that after the surgery they need to be changed their habit of life for at least 6 weeks, either by avoiding of straining and avoiding of sexual intercourse at least for 6 weeks, and they try to keep on with their life, and maybe they find that they prefer to exhaust all the conservative options prior to any kind of definite treatment. Especially care is those women who think of expanding their life, and all the surgical approaches may be somehow be disturbed by any kind of future deliveries and so on. Regarding a little bit about the neuroanatomy, so it's quite interesting that we know that the urethra is actually composed of three muscle layers. The inner part layers are the smooth muscles, either the circular and then the longitudinal, which is the central one. And around that, the peripheral part of the urethra is the striated muscle, the rhabdosphincter. And as we can see, it's not quite concentric, it's more spherical. And we see that the especially in the ventral part, as we see here, it's much thinner regarding the dorsal part. And this is actually the area of the puburethral, pubocervical fascia, as well as the puburethral muscle, which is part of the a branch of the puborectalis, one of the elevator ani. And this area is much more prone to be involved in any pathology of the stress urinary incontinence. Regarding the input of the urethra, so the sympathetic input, as we know, comes from T10 to L1, L2, going along the spinal cord, then through the inferior splanchnic nerves, goes to the synapse of the infilaments and ganglion all the way to hypogastric nerve, and then it innervates actually the inner parts, the longitudinal and the circular urethral smooth muscle. The parasympathetic, which actually originates from S2 to S4 and goes through the pelvic nerve and the pelvic plexus, it actually innervates both those muscles and this in the same time. And there, two of those are actually responsible for the urethral reflex, which the sympathetic part is more the storage part of this reflex, which is a slow tonic reflex that not only distends the bladder by activating the stretch receptors, but also gives a contraction of the urethra, and it's actually had done by the norepinephrine, it's the neurotransmitter, going through the alpha-1 adrenergic receptors. All of those are actually mediated by the pontine micturition center, which is in the brainstem, and it has the central function to do all this mechanism compared with the brainstem and the hypothalamus areas to work as needed during functional voiding. So, by the fact that the contraction urethral smooth muscle may be affected by the alpha adrenergic, it gives us some kind of hope that this mediation can be an optional place for adrenergic treatment for stress urinary incontinence. And that can be done by mediating of the smooth muscle contraction response by those adrenal receptors. So this idea started especially, it was published in the 70s, trying to use the sympathomimetic drugs for this particular problem of stress urinary incontinence. And the reports were quite promising that time. A majority of these patients achieved significant clinical improvement. Another kind of paper from the 70s, it's like, was a good time that review of 21 female article still then can be managed and controlled in the Journal of Urology, and they found that there is an increase in the urethral occlusion pressure in about a third of those patients. But during the years since the 17th, a lot of information keep on, and it was updated in the Cochrane a few times. The last time it's in 2010. Most of these reports were found that in conclusion, it's actually there is only weak evidence to suggest that the active treatment with adrenergic agonist drug is better than the placebo. So the enthusiastic of the 70s sounds not as good right now. Not only that, but although the majority of the adverse effects quite minor, there are a minority of patients who has quite major problems. Most of those are cardiovascular problems, regarding the fact that the adrenergic treatment is not only for this area, but affects other areas in a systemic way. And one of the main talks about that was about the phenylpropylamine and his risk factor for hemorrhagic strokes, which is quite high, especially in the women population, after first use of this treatment. And it's quite important to remember that. That's why all the enthusiastic part seems a bit not as good as we used to think. So after that, we had to find out whether there are other options that we may treat this issue. One of the candidates for that is the hormonal treatment and in women, and that's a lot of effects on that. One of the effects is not only the bulking and thickening of the epithelium of the vagina, but it may have effects on the urethra as well as the bladder neck. And this, there are a few studies about that. One of those studies was published in the British Journal of Obstetrics and Gynecology, and they actually found that there is no improvement in those in the postmenopausal stress incontinence by treating with estradiol valtrate 2 milligrams per day, comparing the placebo. So their conclusion was that it seems unlikely that estrogen has a significant role play. Another study that discussed the same issue is the postmenopausal hormone incontinence study. About more than 1,500 participants were included in this study. And what they did, they not only used the estrogen, but they combined the progestin as a replacement treatment. And we can see here that most of the women had actually the percentage of leakage were actually not changed with or without the treatment. And maybe even more women expressed like worsening of the symptoms compared to those who expressed some improvement. So in this study, we see that the daily oral estrogen plus progestin may even worse the symptoms of stress urinary incontinence. So we came back from to the beginning, and we should try to find other options to treat that. And then maybe one of the targets is actually the rhabdo sphincter by using the somatic innervation. We know it's quite interesting that it's originated there. Like the sphincter motor neuron is located in the ventral horn of the sacral spinal cord in an area which is called the Onuf's nucleus. And this combined to the pudendal nerve, and then the urethral striated muscles, the rhabdo sphincter is actually involved. So maybe the target for looking for those kind of pharmacological treatment is in this area of the nucleus. And it's we know that the urethral reflex, which is called the somatic storage reflex, which actually initiated in response to some sudden increase in the blood pressure, as we know, in stress urinary incontinence after cough, laugh, and so on. And then it's expressed the afferent nerve fibers in the pelvic nerve, and by that, through the pudendal nerve, it contract and affect the striated urethral muscle. So, after examining this area, it's become even much more fascinated because the morphology of the Onuf nucleus is quite unique. The main thing is that it's well located in this area of S1 to S3, and the sphincter motor neurons, when looking and examining it in the electronic microscope, it's quite uniform, and the size is uniform and it's quite intermediate size. Not only that, but the three-dimensional aspect of this morphology seems that there is an extensive segmental interconnections due to the fact of this dense kind of three-dimensional structure. And by looking on these things, it's quite interesting to see and approved by not only then that this area of in the ventral horn may be some kind of affection by another neurotransmitter. Those are the serotoninergic and the noradrenaline transmitters. And this finding is actually suggests the opportunity to treat the stress urinary incontinence just through some kind of influence on this Onuf nucleus, which seems quite promising. There is not only these two neurotransmitters there, but actually quite more of those. One of the main actors is the glutamate, which is some kind of those neurotransmitter that is responsible for the storage reflex by making the on and off switch during the storage part and the off switch during the micturition itself. And the glutamate is released too in this Onuf nucleus area, and by that activating the pudendal nerve to induce the release of the acetylcholine in the end of that, and by that contracting the rhabdo sphincter. So there's actually some effects, And we can see it like kind of stereo, that the glutamate is responsible for the on and off, and the serotonin and the norepinephrine is like responsible for the volume, and it can be working only when the glutamate is on the off position, in the on position. And it's quite interesting to appreciate that, so we won't have any kind of effect during the voiding phase by contracting the rhabdomyosarcomere sphincter. And all this area, it's, you can see it works on, during the storage phase. It's the glutamate is actually off, and during voiding phase, the glutamate is not working, and that's why the noradrenaline and the serotonin doesn't have any effect. We should remember that the serotonin has a role not only in the urinary tract area, but it affects centrally, and it's actually a treatment for depressions, as well as the spinal cord. There is receptors for that, and it's actually one of the treatment for chronic pain kind of diseases. So by facilitating this sphincter activity, we see that the pharmacological agent can actually boost the effect of the serotonin as well as the norepinephrine. And enhancing this effect is maybe even produced and achieved by blocking the reuptake of these nerve terminals. Such effect actually keeps it more effective within the synaptic cleft, and by that, it gives us the options for treatment by the SNRIs, the serotonin or epinephrine reuptake inhibitors, and we see it not only by theory, but there are animal models that check that, and we see in one of these research, there is an saline infusion, and during the infusion we see that there is some external urethral sphincter working and extracting the blood pressure. If we use some kind of irritative infusion like acetic acetate, we see that it's working like more strenuously. But then after using the luxotin, which is the SNRI inhibitors, we see there is an increase in the sphincter activity, but this activity is only during the filling phase and not when during the micturition contraction, which happens here. So the luxotin itself is the selective serotonin and norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor, and the effect is actually on the striated urethral sphincter is quite unique, and it's important to appreciate that comparing to a usage only of SSRIs or adrenaline, that then the effect on this area is actually not working so well, and we need this simultaneous both aspects of the receptor effect to be treated. So that has how it looks like demonstratively. We see the SNRIs, and they actually they block the reuptake transport in the end-terminal of the synapse, and by that there is quite a lot more of norepinephrine available as well as the serotonin during the time of the action. So after looking about the theory and the animal model, there was a quite interesting change, and it started actually on 2000 and like the second part of 2003 until the first half of 2004. There was about three consecutive phase three trials that was published. The first one was published in the Journal of Urology in October 2003, and this incontinence group, the luxotin urinary incontinence study group, came from mostly from North America, and they examined more than 680 women suffering of stress urinary incontinence in 55 centers in USA and Canada, and their inclusion criteria seemed like predominancy of stress urinary incontinence, at least seven or more episodes per week, which appears to be like moderate kind of symptoms of stress urinary incontinence. Normal diurnal and nocturnal frequency, quite good amount of the bladder capacity, as well as positive evidence of cost stress test or a stress PET test. The protocol was by starting with pre-screening and pre-therapy for 2 weeks, and then they started the duloxetine of in the dose of 40 milligrams twice per day, and it's quite important, and we'll talk about the dose later. And they compare it to the placebo, and they have few visiting every month for 3 months. That's how the protocol looks. And the result was actually there was an improvement in the amount of the amount of these stress urinary frequencies in the group of the duloxetine, and it's what's a quite significant improvement comparing to the placebo. And not only that, but they found that this improvement in the incontinence quality of life score as well, and it was it seems like quite a good result. Unfortunately, they had the side effects and the adverse events, and the adverse events were quite high. Most of those were either gastrointestinal or some cognitive side effects, and it was much higher in the duloxetine group comparing the placebo. So their conclusion was actually that the efficacy and safety data support duloxetine as potentially pharmacological treatment, but this improvement must be weighted against the considerable discontinuation rate, and which appeared quite high. It was about 20 to 24% of the patients in the treatment group. Another follow-up, another study, which is interesting, it was from a European group mostly. Some of it still were Canadian, so it's the treatment of European and Canadian women with stress urinary incontinence. The case definition was actually the same, and the intervention and the protocol was equal. And their results were that the incontinence episode frequency actually decreased by using the duloxetine, but they didn't find and didn't reveal any significant difference regarding the incontinence quality of life. In this study, the discontinuing therapy was either high, like about 22%, and one of the things, like discussion issue, were why there was no change in the incontinence quality of life, and it maybe they included those patients who discontinued very early as well due to the side effects. The third consecutive research during this time came from other parts of the world. Most of it was in South America, South Africa, and Australia, but from Europe either. And the protocol actually was the same. They found the same significant improvement using the duloxetine comparing to the placebo. But here, as well, the discontinuation rate was quite high, about 17%. And the nausea had been the most common reason for this discontinuation. So if summarizing all these three consecutive trials, quite big amount of patients, we find that the duloxetine-treated patient had 50% or greater median decrease in the incontinence episode frequency, but they have a high rate of treatment discontinuation due to the side effects. And it's very important to remember that all those trials were supported by the industry, especially the Eli Lilly, which the duloxetine is one of that choice. And what happened after that is actually fascinating, because after those three trials, the European Union Society the regulatory authorities of the European Union approved very shortly after that the duloxetine as use of stress urinary incontinence. And the North American authorities didn't approve it very shortly after that, and actually they didn't approve it since then. And it's very interesting that this issue, I'm not sure it's only a medical aspect or some other aspect of this thing, and like the point of view is quite different, and it's very fascinating to see that. So the main other articles regarding that are definitely come mostly from Europe where this drug was approved. And we see like in the real life, it's quite interesting that even in Europe and the European Union, it's actually quite a heterogenic kind of union, and there's a big difference between the countries. And I show you some of the spectrum of this difference. So one spectrum is what is happening in Germany, and they're actually very enthusiastic with this treatment, and they examined what are the documentation of the ongoing large scale of those women, and they collected the data during the baseline and after months and 3 months regarding the initial doses. And what they found, they checked the result was in about 8,000 women, and they found that a total of 90% reported reduced in the frequency of stress urinary incontinence episodes, and it's quite good results. Many of those women actually received lower duloxetine doses, some kind of take-home messages regarding the high adverse events and the discontinuation that we saw in the researchers that mentioned previously. But still, the adverse events were, although reduced, they were still quite high and were about 12% of the women. And they actually examined it and saw the effect by using 20 milligrams comparing 40 milligrams and 80 milligrams. And they saw that those women who found that there is no more stress urinary episodes were about 24% in the 20 milligram dose, and was higher, significantly higher, 28% in the higher doses. But there was actually no difference between the 80 milligram dose and the 40 milligram dose, and it's quite improving this aspect. Again, this study, we should remember, that was funded and sponsored by Eli Lilly. And the other spectrum is what happened in Norway. Norway is a country of 4.5 million population. It's interesting that all the Scandinavian countries, they have a quite good and decent database. And this the duloxetine was introduced there in the end of 2004, and actually withdrawn after less than 3 years regarding the industrial strategy, that there was a like lack of buying that and due to the economical aspects. So they investigated epidemiology during these 3 years, and they found out some interesting results. First, that the most prescribed was by the gynecologist as well as the general practitioner, and it's even after extrapolating the amount of those specialists. And the persistence of the use was very low, and actually only 12% in Norway after 1 year. And that's why one of the reasons that this drug is not used anymore in Norway. And we see this kind of change during the first year. From here to here, it's about 80% stopped using that. And it's quite interesting to appreciate why the possible reasons for this thing, and comparing to the trials that have been done prior. So maybe it's lack of effect, and the duloxetine is, we know, it's actually seldom cured the incontinence, but it improves the symptoms. So those women who have actually high expectation may be disappointed and stop using the drug. Other things that we should remember, that there may be some kind of difference comparing the randomized control trials comparing to the real-life situation, which appears to be different. The third issue is the validity of sponsored randomized control trials that run by manufacturers comparing to the real-life issues. The fourth thing that may be concerning is the cost of the treatment, which is quite high. And actually, most of the treatments in West Europe has some kind of in the medical basket. And if it doesn't in the medical, the patient should buy it by themselves, and the cost of it may affect of the compliance. And the other thing that we should remember, that maybe there is some kind of psychiatric stigma, because we know that duloxetine is actually approved for the depression patient, and by that maybe people prefer not to be like in the stigma of psychiatric treated patient. So if we think that there is some kind of despair about that, even of all this data, this is actually the new EUA guidelines of urinary incontinence, and it was published this March, and it's quite interesting, and I encourage you to read that, because there are interesting things and like regarding other treatments, especially for urge urinary incontinence, and they are actually quite liberal regarding Botox, neurotransmission, neurostimulation, and so on. So if you're speaking about the grade of recommendation that they're discussing in these guidelines, we see that the duloxetine has a level of evidence 1, but interestingly that the grade of recommendation is only B. Maybe even though that it's randomized controlled trials, maybe due to the fact that they're industrial sponsored, somehow reduce it to category B, but it's still better comparing the other adrenergic component as well as the hormonal treatment and ephedrine and the SSRI itself, which is actually not recommended. What's interesting in this algorithm, it's quite a busy one, but I'd like to pay your attention for the incontinence patient. After the general assessment, those who have stress incontinence, one of the options that in the guidelines is the using of SNRIs, and it's quite interesting, and only after that using other vagina devices, and only the European guidelines right now, it's only after failing of those treatment, it's go to the specialized management, and here in the specialized management, they are mentioning all the other, like after the initial therapy fails, mentioning the other definitive kind of treatments. We discussed only about women right now, but there are some evidence about male stress urinary incontinence as well, and I think that some people in the audience will be interested in that. And one of these articles examined all the clinical trials, and it's quite a busy slide, but we'll see that most of it is case series, especially due to the adrenergic treatment. But for the SNRIs, there is one randomized controlled trial with more than 100 patients. And in this trial, which came from Italy, they tried to assess the efficacy and safety of the duloxetine. And it's interesting, they did it by comparing two groups, one which treated only with pelvic physiotherapy, and the other group was treated either, this one is by both of these duloxetine as well as the pelvic physiotherapy. In Italy it's called duloxetina, as we see here. And what's interesting that it started just 10 days after removal of the catheter after the repropubic prostatectomy, and they followed up those patients for 16 weeks, and then they just discontinued the drug and saw in an open phase what's going on. And we see that the events was actually, there was less events of stress urinary incontinence episodes in the combined group, which is group A, comparing to the only physiotherapy group. And this was all the way in these 16 weeks. And when they stopped the treatment with the Luxottine and continued only with physiotherapy, we see that it's actually this significant decrease was actually changed. And the same thing regarding the quality of life score, which was significant in the phase of treatment and then was not significant anymore after ceasing the treatment. So the summary is that there is a significant improvement in this post-prostatectomy group treated combinedly by the Luxottine as well as physiotherapy, and the combination therapy provides good treatment for those patients. Another trial of it's actually a preliminary result, and it's like published a couple of months ago, and it's a prospective randomized placebo-controlled double-blind trial regarding all those mild to moderate prostatectomy incontinence. And they started in this trial in 40 milligrams for 1 week, and then if they just doubled the dose for 80 milligrams, and just prior to stopping and discontinuation, they just tapered it off again to 40 milligrams. And in this preliminary trials, the conclusion is actually that it's the treatment of 80 milligrams is superior over the placebo regarding the events of the stress urinary incontinence as well as the quality of life scores. Again, this study was sponsored by Eli Lilly. So just touch base a little bit in the end about the alternative medicine for those who don't have the opportunity, those countries that doesn't have the opportunity for other pharmacological, and the patient are seeking for some kind of oral pharmacological treatment. So it's some anecdotal kind of trials. One of those, by using Chinese herb for stress urinary incontinence, I found this article. It's published in the one of the Japanese journal, and I found it's like a case series of small kind of 23 subjects, and they use some kind of ingredients, including ginseng and citrus and cucurbit and other, and they found some effect. There are other anecdotal kind of paper regarding another herb, which is the ephedra herb. Maybe the ephedrine actually has some kind of work. So the conclusion of the talk, actually, after reviewing all the pharmacological effects, that the pharmacological therapy provides additional component to the arsenal of the stress urinary incontinence treatment. The adrenergic drugs provide a minimal therapeutic effect and have an optional severe side effects. The SNRIs appears to be acceptable option despite the fact that there is a high dropout that may be related to the dosage of the treatment. And the data regarding men is still scarce and preliminary. And regarding the alternative medicine, we should know about it. We should know it's available, but the scientific reports are right now quite only anecdotal one. So this was quite a short review regarding pharmacological treatment with stress urinary incontinence. And if you have questions, please.